Hey, everyone.
I'm just seeing the attendees come in, and I'm seeing some people I know and a bunch of people I don't know. So I just wanted to give a shout out. I think Annalisa and Uncle Bear, I think, are here. I know Sarah is downstairs. That's my beautiful wife. She might not be watching. I think I saw a Joy out there. I don't know if it's the Joy I know, but if so, hey, Joy. Who else do I? Linda, it's good seeing you. I see a Margot out there. I know a Margot. Bopshi, good seeing you and Da. I hope you two are doing great. And then to those of you I don't know, it's great having you here as well. So I hope everyone is having a great night.
Yeah, great turnout so far. This is Chloe from the Green Mountain Club. We're going to give everyone a few minutes to join. So make yourself comfortable, grab a glass of water or a snack or a blanket, whatever you need. And we'll get going in just a few minutes.
And I'm looking at the photo of me off to the left of your screen. And I'm wondering if anyone can find my hair. Please give it back. I seem to have lost it all.
Sean, when was that photo taken?
That photo was from probably 2000, maybe 1999. That was in the Calmeopsis wilderness of Southern Oregon. We were working on trails that got ravaged by the biscuit fire. So that dirt on my arms and face is actually ash. And every single day we'd jump in the river and clean ourselves off and never get clean enough. Yeah. And we actually once almost started our own wildfire there with an old Coleman Whisper light. Oh man, we were close.
Oh no. Well, that's a great story. I'm sure you'll have to mention that one again as we, you know, wait for all of our participants to join. You know, we're using webinar mode for all of you out there in the audience, which maybe you're accustomed to by now, but we can't see any of you. So we love to invite a little bit of audience participation via the chat feature, which you should see on the right side of your screen. If you just want to let us know where you're tuning in from, I'm from my home office here in Burlington, Vermont. Sean, where are you tuning in from?
I am not from my home office. I am in a hotel in Ascutney, Vermont, visiting my dad and stepmom. They are downstairs. I see Albany and San Francisco and Windy North Hero. I was just going to say, I know we have someone from Idaho. And Drew, I'm going to say you're not from Michigan, but from Norwich. It's great seeing you as well.
Hi there, Howard, GMC board president, coming in from Hyde Park.
Thanks for joining us.
So, you know, this is our second year of doing our speaker series virtually. And, you know, we miss being able to see everyone in person. But before this Zoom world, we weren't able to have a cross-continental audience. So that's really exciting to see where everyone is tuning in from.
Well, and I was just, George, thank you for that. I appreciate that. And I'm just looking at the chat come rolling in. And if you were all my students, I'd say, hold on, speak one at a time. So I was trying to keep track of where everyone is coming from, and I miss most of it. I know there's someone from North Carolina here that I've not heard from, John. Good. Oh, there you go, right there, John. Good timing, good seeing you as well. Thanks everyone for coming.
We can get started in just a couple minutes here. I imagine we'll still have some people joining. But I'm so excited to welcome Sean Prentiss here tonight. Sean is an author, a poet, an experienced trail builder, and currently a professor at Norwich University. And tonight he'll be presenting stories and poems from his memoir, Crosscut, which was inspired by his time leading youth trail crews, I believe, out in the Pacific Northwest wilderness. So really excited to hear more from Sean in a few minutes. My name is Chloe Miller from the Green Mountain Club. I'm the communications manager. So I'll be helping facilitate with Sean tonight. I'll be reviewing the chat and Q&A. And I'm just going to run through a little introduction to GMC, some thank yous, a quick overview of how the Zoom functions will work tonight. And then I will turn it over to Sean in just a few minutes. So this event is part of the James P. Taylor Outdoor Adventure Speaker Series that the Green Mountain Club has been putting on for the last 30 years. We bring people together to build community and share stories about outdoor adventures and experiences and perspectives. Like I said earlier, this is the second annual virtual Taylor Series. So welcome all to the world of Zoom again. So if you're here, most of you likely know a little bit about the Green Mountain Club. You had to come across our website to register for this event, but I'll give everyone a quick overview in case this is your first time hearing about us or you want to know more. So the Green Mountain Club was founded in 1910 when we built the Long Trail, which stretches from the Massachusetts border of Vermont all the way up to the Canadian border. And today we still maintain the Long Trail as well as all of its side trails, the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, and hiking trails in the Northeast Kingdom. So over 500 miles of trail in Vermont. If you've ever been hiking here in Vermont, whether that's up Camel's Hump or Mount Mansfield or on the boardwalk in Smuggler's Notch, you've probably been on a trail that's cared for by GMC. You may have seen one of our backcountry caretakers who during hiking season live out on the summits and ponds along the trail. And every year we staff seasonal trail crews, caretakers, and then up to 1,000 volunteers who help care for the backcountry campsites, overnight shelters, privies, and trails. So we do all of this so that Vermonters and visitors to Vermont can get out and enjoy the trail. So if you want to, connect with the Green Mountain Club and get involved, we're on social media at the Green Mountain Club. Our website is greenmountainclub.org. And then if you're interested in getting into hiking more, I'd encourage you to discover what our visitor center has to offer. So 5 days a week, we have folks on the phone and available via email who can help you plan the perfect hike for you, your family, whatever you're looking for. Whether that's your first hike in the state or you're planning an end-to-end through hike of the Long Trail. We really have some great experts in the Visitor Center and they love to help people plan for their hikes. And I will paste the contact info and some other links into the chat as we go.
And Chloe, I'm just going to add in right here. Yeah. I hate to interrupt you. You're doing great work. if you need more reasons to pay attention and love the Green Mountain Club. Right before I came up, I was eating dinner with my dad, my stepmom, my wife, and my daughter. And my wife just gave me a hug and said, "Do me proud. This is the Green Mountain Club." And I think her big thing was, "Don't screw it up. They do great work." So pay attention to the Green Mountain Club. We love what you all do.
Yes, and that reminded me to switch slides. So thank you, Sean. that's a little overview of the Green Mountain Club. And I did want to take a moment to thank our corporate sponsors, our business members, and all of the members who make our work possible. This program tonight is brought to you by Lenny's Shoe and Apparel, who's one of our corporate sponsors that donate to help us support the trail. So Lenny's is a great place to stop if you're in the market for hiking boots, hiking socks, other outdoor apparel. If you're a Green Mountain Club member, you also receive a 10% off discount of any purchase. And if you want more information on membership, I will paste that into the chat. So quick overview of how we'll use Zoom tonight. You may be familiar with it already, but it doesn't hurt. So like I said, it's a webinar. We'll turn it over to Sean and he'll go through his stories and his poems. He has some amazing slides and stuff to show us. Throughout the program, you're free to enter questions in the Q&A box. That should be in your little tool panel at the bottom of your screen. We're going to save those questions for the end and Sean will answer them live. But if it's a quick technical question or question about GMC, I can probably answer that as we go. So feel free to put any and all questions in the Q&A box. Feel free to share what you're thinking in the chat. These webinars are tough because we can't see all your faces. So we love to see and read what you're thinking as we go. So do utilize that chat box. And if you're having a tech issue or something urgent, there's also the raise hand feature, and I can get in touch with you directly via the chat feature. Okay, so all of that housekeeping aside, I'm so excited to introduce Sean. Sean Prentiss, author, poet, and experienced trail builder. He'll be presenting stories and poems from his memoir, Crosscut. We're also honored that Sean offered to host and judge GMC's December Nature Poetry Contest, which we ran in anticipation of this event. We had nearly 70 submissions from more than 35 of you, so that was hugely impressive. There are so many artists and poets out there. So at the end, Sean will actually do us the honor of reading the winning poems for us. After that, we'll open it up for questions. So all in all, we'll be about an hour, and we're so excited you're all here. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen and turn it over to Sean.
All right, so of course I immediately clicked the wrong button.
Take your time.
Oh man, all right, there we go. I clicked the button right below the button. So let's do this right this time. And Bobshi, watch what you say. You'll give me a big head. I also saw Walter out there. If it's the Walter I know, I hope you're doing great. And Ellen as well. But first off, thank you, Chloe. I really appreciate everything you said. Also, thanks so much to the Green Mountain Club. As I mentioned earlier, my wife and I have had connections to the Green Mountain Club for, I guess it's going on 30 years now, which makes me feel really, really old. Also, to Lenny's, thanks for sponsoring this. Chloe, you mentioned you can get hiking boots there, but heck, let's get some trail building boots there as well. Get a nice 10-inch high logger boot with some good logger heels and a logger tongue, and we'll do some chainsaw work with Lenny's boots. So let's do that. And talking about the Green Mountain Club and the Long Trail, my cousin Mel and I first hiked the Long Trail back in 1994. We just did a couple of nights and we had an amazing time. We ended up at Mad River Glen and came back down. It was really one of my first experiences in Vermont. And it just really taught me a ton about just my love for backpacking. And then my wife, well before she met me, she hiked the Long Trail in 2002 with two of her wonderful friends. And then once my daughter was born, my wife gave me a present, and I'll talk more about it later, of section hiking the Long Trail. So I did that in 2018 and 2019 with Barry, who's here tonight. And so for all those reasons and so many more, it's such a pleasure to give this talk today. So what I hope to do today is kind of do a hybrid talk and poetry reading at the exact same time and just kind of blend the two right in together. And I'll talk about my time with the Northwest Youth Corps while reading some of the poems from the book. And then I'm gonna talk about very quickly my next project, which hopefully you find interesting. And then finally I'll announce some of those winners. And I'm really excited to talk about the Nature Poetry Contest winners. So I'm gonna start out with a poem that kind of just starts the book and kind of centers us. I discover a Pulaski, a trail tool I haven't cradled in a dozen years, leaned under the eaves of this civilian conservation corps cabin, converted into a writing residency. I bear this cutting tool into a nearby meadow of quavering lilies and irises and find its balance points. At a dead end down, I raise the axe edge above my head and drive hips and shoulders into the swing, feeling metal sliver air before blade chaws into pine. Fists of bark and sapwood leap like spawning sockeye salmon surging upriver. I swing again and again, showering this meadow in trees' rays, realizing so many things have changed these years. But some things remain, though hidden, in our fibers of muscle, remembering and always ready. And that poem was written here at the Aspen Guard Station in Mancos, Colorado, in the La Plata Mountains. And I went to the Aspen Guard Station for a writing residency, and I brought my future wife, Sarah, with me. And all day I would work on my first book, Finding Abby, The Search for Edward Abbey and His Hidden Desert Grave. And all I was doing was kind of really pragmatic revisioning. And it was really important. It's you know, what I needed to do to write the book and finish the book. But it's not very artistic. It's more of just kind of nuts and bolts and cleaning up messes. And my wife, being the brilliant editor that she is, she said, you had an artist residency. You need to do more than just revise. You need to write something new. But I'd be in Finding Abby all day for hours and hours, 6, 7, 8 hours a day. And it was hard to just imagine doing anything more than revising. So I would think about it, and mostly I would think about it while we were hiking trails after I got done work. And we'd hike trails all around the La Plata Mountains. We'd hike Hesperus Peak, Shark's Tooth. We'd hike all these other trails. And these were all trails that I'd built or maintained with a crew a dozen years before. And we had spent 2, 3, 4 weeks right here, right in the very area, not at the guard station itself, but camped a mile or two down the road. And as we were hiking, I would just tell Sarah all these stories about this crew member and that crew member, about building this, about that rainstorm, about this mud pit. And slowly it realized to the two of us that what I should be writing is trail poems. So that's when this entire book started, is right here at the Aspen Guard Station in La Plata's. And it continued. And then a dozen years before that, maybe 15 years before that, I guess maybe 30 years before that, I grew up in Pennsylvania, in Eastern Pennsylvania. And then when I graduated from high school, I went to Western Colorado University, and I was a business graduate. That was back in 1994. And I had no idea what to do with that degree. And so I decided to do what any good business graduate would do, and that is to join the Peace Corps. And I ended up volunteering with the Blue and John Crow Mountains down in Jamaica. And then when I came home, I started bumming around the U.S. And by 26, I have lived in two countries and 3 states in an apartment, a cabin, a shed, and a car, running and running. The city where my lover lives in is an assemblage of noise, factory of waste, the racket of rush hour, noosing a knot within my chest. I'm tired of temp work, washing dishes, answering the phone. Santa Fe Community College, how may I direct your call? Northwest Youth Corps claims I'll get 150 tent nights. I've never handled a trail tool. I've only backpacked once. I accept the moment the job is offered. So then I get a job offer from the Northwest Youth Corps. I have no idea what it entails. I don't know anything about trail building. I've literally kind of, sort of, almost built trails twice in Jamaica. I don't know anything about the Pacific Northwest. I don't think I'd ever been there before that, since I was maybe 1 year old, and I've never worked with youth at all. But I accept the job, and NYC tells me what to buy. So I buy a Hickory shirt, a Eureka tent, Carhartt pants, and 6 days before I repair to the woods for a 5-month hitch, a salesman hefts over a pair of 10-inch high Wesco boots with logger tongues and a logger heel, thick as a burled fist of wood. $200, he says, but these boots will be worth every dime on the trail. I'll earn that cash in 3 days of building Duffy trails, one Pulaski swing at a time, or running a hot steel chainsaw till my biceps and triceps scream louder than a 2-stroke engine could dream of whining. But my feet, no matter the miles, and there will be hundreds, will never complain. I'll take them, I say, sliding city feet deep into new leather homes. So, after buying this gear, I kiss my girlfriend, Catherine, goodbye. I fly out to Portland, end up sleeping on a couple of airport seats, take a bus down to Eugene, and then I hitch a ride to Northwest Youth Corps. And there, we leaders in training, we go into the woods at Silver Falls State Park for a week of training, and we're going to learn everything we possibly can. And then these April nights, shivering inside white wall tents, we echo the trail terms Woods Boss teaches us. Angle of repose, rock bar, check dam. These terms become hymns we sing during this week-long coastal mountain training, learning to dig forest into trail, water bar, hinge, turnpike. We future Northwest Youth Corps leaders quiz each other over what these terms mean in the force of our lives. Hazelhoe, Hog Ho, Cut Banks. Woods Box preaches, so it is our trail crew gospel. Woods Boss preaches, so we preach back. Pulaski, McLeod, Pickaxe. Adjourn sleep, hands instinctively curled as if still clutching trail tools. We dream mumble their names. So during training, we get taught everything. And it's some kind of mess of learning where you wake up at 4:30 in the morning and you work till 9:30, 10 at night, and you learn how to build trail. You learn how to repair trail. You learn how to build turnpikes and water bars and check dams. But you also learn how to play with chainsaws. So we get to spend days first cutting really, really small trees, dead and downs, and then slowly working our way bigger and bigger. And then once the day was done, we had to repair our saws and each sap component, flywheel, sprocket cover, chain catcher, laid before us leaders in training, a dissection, directions without a roadmap, scattered seed from a flower. We studied this orange saw as one studies a new lover, learn how this hard burl of engine misfires unless cared for like a child. These parts come alive, chain tensioner, gas oil mixture, carburetor box, hex nuts, and clutch cover become organs, blood, lungs, joints, mechanical skin. Dogs, we purred, awed by the sharp biting pivots. Our round files pause on the one elements that rip apart these forks, the chain, teeth sharpened, glistening. And then after 7, 8, 9, 10 days of nonstop training, nonstop work, training ends at Silver Falls State Park. And after 7 days, we pack up these white wall tents, breakdown stove, plunge sleeping bags into stuff sacks. We van away from backwoods training towards soon enough our own crews and 5 months of projects. But not today. Today, we erupt into town, find an RV park, rent $3.50 showers, step within hot rains until too soon we realize it pipes away this week's history. And we would do that each, at the end of each week, we would take a shower. And if you saw that first picture of me, that's what we would often look like. We'd wear the same clothes for a week on end. And then we'd have a city set of clothes, which were just a cleaner version of our dirty clothes. And after training, we're given 4 days off to get ready for our 6 to 10 week session in the woods. So we sleep, relax, read, drink beers, worry about upcoming trail season, which is going to be my first ever. I have no idea what I'm about to get myself into, and I'm about to get myself into a whole lot. But I also think about the world I've left behind. And at a Mustang gas station stop, I find an empty payphone booth and call across our massive continent to tell Catherine I found a new world bigger than anything I'd ever dreamed. Like when you found God, I longed to whisper. I long to tell her I love her one final time. We'll call in 3 weeks, early May, once logger boots next kiss concrete. It is night at this Mustang, later night in her city. Tonight I am drunk on summer, on fatigue, on the task ahead. My hand strokes the coiled cord as I listen to her phone ringing, unanswered. And then you get done with training, you get done with your break. And you go to Northwest Youth Corps headquarters. And their headquarters is an old elementary school converted into a nonprofit. And they have kind of the play fields out back, the soccer, football area. And there'll be 40 youth, 16 to 19 year olds, just milling back. They're all trying to look super cool, just like we're trying to do as new leaders. And the woods boss, who is my boss, he oversees four groups. He goes through this group of youth, and some of them are adjudicated from the court system. Some of them are honor students, both men and women, all sorts of diversity. He'll go through and he'll try to create a crew for you. And he tries to get a good crew member, a bad crew member, men, women, all kind of together so that you have your crew. And this is your crew. And day one, I drive this new crew of teens south on Oregon's I-5 towards the poison oak infested Cascade Range. Six teens paid hourly slump in the row seats of our shimmering white van. Apathetic faces gaze at blurred furs as we abandon Eugene for spring and summer in tents. When we return, April flowers will be replaced by September leaves. In the rear view, I scan faces trying to tease out history. Today, I can only guess. For a first-time crew leader, it can't seem to get any worse. Strings, a homeless heroin dabbler who plays guitar like songbirds sing. Serious, hooked on pot and breaking into houses to get more money to smoke himself away. Red, a shy redheaded McDonald's assistant manager, one of only two women on our crew, along with Stacy, a meth addict, will be here so few days. We never know her myths. Boone, recently out of alcohol rehab, wears wavy black hair and a ponytail like Shiloh, except Shiloh sports a smiley face wound from ear to Adam's apple to ear, a week old and scabbed over where someone tried to saw his head off. The seven of us, today strangers, will spend months building trail, returning to primitive. Today, tomorrow, the 5 months ahead, I will learn this crew the way rock learns erosion, incrementally. And then with this crew, and by the way, you see a whole bunch of pictures, but none of the people in any of these photos are the crew that I write about, and all the names have been changed, but they're all wonderful people that I love dearly. But then the seven of us, we drive all around the West. For this book, we're in Oregon and Washington, and this map drawn by my great artist friend, Tim Calkins, highlights where we all go around the Pacific Northwest. But later crews will go to Idaho, Colorado, Utah, Arizona, New Mexico, building trail, doing tree work, doing noxious weed eradication. And each week or two or three, we move to some new state or national park until we are embraced our first 3 weeks by 19,000 acres of andesite and basalt monoliths, phoenixing from the western slope of the Southern Cascades, up a convolution of logging roads we drive till we terminate at a sign that reads Boulder Creek Wilderness. And here, we rest, or actually nest. And when we're in the woods and in the wilds, some days were so beautiful. And I'd ask you right now to close your eyes a moment and then open them to that babbling creek. What is its name? Maybe Boulder Creek or Rattlesnake or some other name. So beautiful, you long to hold it in your mouth, run your tongue across the sound, hush its name back into the full moon breeze. Let the creek course its way towards the North Umpqua River. This moment I learn life is too big to hold. It is only something to be tasted, a savoring. And we were in the woods for weeks on end. That the other world felt so far away. And week by week, we grow toward a condensed language. Words disremembered, abandoned from tents and saw packs. What use for the word sink? When might we utter closet or phone or bank account? These words unneeded as a third thumb, unneeded as money or credit card. Girlfriend becomes little more than a weekend dream. After 4 weeks of woods living, I give you TV. I give you movie theater and radio. Do you want more words that these backwood winds strip away? Take traffic jam, take fuel pump, take 9 to 5 God, take commuting, take Howard Stern, take pavement, take concrete, take we beg of you. Microwaves and power lines, take nightly news. We give each and every one away because these industrial words, they taint our wild new memories. But everything with living in the woods for months at a time, many months in a year, comes at a cost. And living in one world means giving up another. And remember when I told you this crew had disremembered so many words? How we gave those words, cable TV, desk, VCR, coffee maker, back to society, begged you to dispose of them, just broken sounds, glass in the mouth, forget all that. For now, think of 2 months living in a tent, weeks on spike without shower or shaving, days without changing hickory shirt or boxers, clothes faded to rags, stained of earth. Everything is conceived from rock and dirt anyway. I need to talk about an aching. Another crew leader, Ethan, and I spent a night in Hood River. Tonight, we are human and in love with our women thousands of miles away. We also need something stronger than iodine-treated water, so we spelunk into a midday bar. But I'm meandering. I find a payphone, slide quarters into its hard belly. Catherine's everything I am not. Pulsating lights, dance club, Marlboro lights burn to the butt, hands of clay, her voice huddled in a megapolis of subway lines and tunnels. Why is it so easy to talk to you and not her? She fusses across phone lines about kissing lips, not mine. I sever our line and stumble, not yet drunk, towards our bar. This June night, Ethan teaches me last lessons of drinking to excess, waking in some $40 motel to an alcohol fog. There was once possibility. Come haze morning, no one loves me, except the perfect balance of the Pulaski. I have no home except that echoing tent, that sleeping bag that no matter how tightly it sheathes this body, never feels like arms, like thin lips. This exact moment, I commit only to crew, to trails. And it's not just trying to date that was hard. Living with a family of teens for months is another exhausting struggle. You're with them from 4:30 or 5 in the morning until 8, 9 at night, 18-hour days working. You have no peace, no time. And the crew would wonder why I'd get so frustrated. They'd ask, why am I yelling? I'll tell you why I'm yelling, Strings. Because you're late every freaking morning. Because you left the bastard file out last night and now it's rust. Because you and Boone argue each night about how messy your tent is rather than cleaning it the hell up. Because Sirius burned last night's rice even after I told him I could smell the burn. Because I haven't dreamed of 6 hours of sleep in weeks. Because my feet are trenched from working under rain and in Whiskey Creek. Because my thumb is a knob of undoctored pus, because I haven't kissed a girl in 93 days, and I haven't seen a girl I can kiss in 26, and Catherine is kissing someone nameless, because my tent sleeps upon a bed of granite, so the only thing I hold at night is rock, because I'm sick of being a leader, desperate for one night at the Trophy Room Bar in Prospect, Oregon, so I can complain about you, all of you. Since I can't tell any of you this, I commiserate only with cedars. They're miserable conversationalists. And that was the truth. You just very rarely, unless you had your assistant leader, no one to talk with. You know, you couldn't share those thoughts with the crew. So just end up in your own mind. But we'd be out in the woods for weeks on end, months. And then all of a sudden it's autumn. It's the end of the season. And I look at myself and as you can see here, I'm greasy hair. My hair is standing up because it's got chainsaw bar oil in it. I've got a wild beard because I haven't shaved it since my last day off many, many weeks before. And it reminds me that these clothes were once wool of sheep, bowl of cotton, till sewing machines overlocked these fabrics together. Work pants now aged into holes, shined into knees by the kiss of dirt, colored by rainbow chainsaw oil in the dark cloud of gasoline. This hickory tailored by rivulets of sweat, these garments wear like fur upon the bull of the woods. And then finally, it's our last days. And just imagine that you've spent 6 to 10 weeks with the same group of people and not like you would with your friends, but like you would, you know, sort of like a pandemic family where you are with them 24 hours a day, every single day, never apart. And then all of a sudden it's the end of our days. And these last moments after months constructing trails, digging society from our bones, this crew is transformed into Enkidu before he loved Shamhat, when he spoke the language of those who ate grass and drank from water holes. At our end, I fear Enkidu's spirit deserts us, each of us soon exiled as Enkidu was. Too soon we return to the rule of ruining cities, no longer home beside bear and elk, no longer drinking from crystalline creeks. And extra credit to anyone who knows what that book comes from. You can toss it in the chat and Chloe will give you 5 extra points on your final exam. And then the season is done. And you pack up all your tools, you fold up your tent one last time, you put it in your white, shimmering white van, and you leave the woods, you leave the wilds, you drive I-5 back towards Eugene, back towards that converted elementary school where all of this began. And we have a long list of lasts and finals until we sling no more dirt, till we birth no more trail, till we climb from our van, till we, known only for so long as a crew, become you and you and you and me. And then let us travel back to that time where we started at the Aspen Guard Station. So in that time, I was living in a city, Grand Rapids, Michigan. This is somewhere around 2010, 2011. And I'm living in Grand Rapids, Michigan, far from the mountains and trails. And I'm a man of tents and woods. And in the city, I feel completely alone. And the memories of the trails haunt me. And this is where the book ends. And this is where this part of the talk will end, with this final poem of me in Grand Rapids thinking backwards. And when it is lonely here in Grand Rapids and those wildernesses seem so much further than beyond the 100th meridian, I pace the confines of this house until I end up in my living room closet, flipping through 12-year-old photo albums. I almost knead earthen images into Duffy Peninsula soil or St. Helens ash dirt, leading closer towards snapshots. I feel wet winds sloughing off. Instead of closet walls, it's a blanket of Devil's Club. Instead of hardwood floors, it is towering false cedars. Fingers on these photos, I realize that if I plastered this world, there'd be no straight line highways, no 9-to-5, no subdivisions assembly line into broken images of Abraham Levitz and son. I set down photos and stumble into nightfall of mortgage houses, bury faces into the yard's only tree, then low into the dirt's rake. One more bit of extra credit, Dad, I expect you to get this one right. Who is Abraham Levitz and son? So that'll be your next extra credit. And once again, Chloe will give you another 5 points on your final exam. And that is my house in Grand Rapids, Michigan, the closet I'm talking about. I don't know if you can see my cursor, it's right here. And I kept all my photo albums, and this is the tree that I'm talking about smelling. So we're all done with Crosscut, and I hope you enjoyed listening to those poems about my time as a trail builder. That covers some of the poems in the book. But I also wanted to very quickly talk about my next poetry project, which is going to be a collection of poems, much like Crosscut, but about hiking the long trail. And it's about hiking it with Barry, my wife's uncle. And it's also about, of course, the long trail, but it's also about home and fatherhood. My wife gave me again the present of time to hike the long trail when my daughter was young. It was a chance to have some solitude and some quietude. And one of the things I found that was so interesting is I love being alone. I love solitude. I love reading. I love hiking. But the entire time I was on the long trail, I kept thinking of my family at home. So the long trail was kind of this big metaphor for hiking home. So this next project is about the long trail, about home and fatherhood. And I'm just going to share one quick poem from the trail. As we prepare to take our first step from Barry's truck, I cradle Sarah's Leki Makalus, which are black and gray and chipped from when she hiked this trail in 2002. These poles have plunged into every puddle of long trail mud. Then never done, Sarah, and these poles hike the Appalachian John Muir trails. This time, Sarah stays home with little girl. And by the way, little girl is downstairs listening right now. I think she should be in bed right now. While I hike to see what she saw. These poles connect us. I slide fingers through straps, grab hand grips, almost as if I'm holding Sarah's hand, as if we hike this trail together, as if she's pointing a pole off trail saying, look at that beautiful trillium, or maybe she is pointing at the trail saying, time for you two to start hiking. So we do, letting her old poles guide me onward towards home. So that's the next project I'm working on. I thought I would just share it because this is the Green Mountain Club and I'm writing all about the long trail. So I'm excited for more free time to work on that. So now I'm really excited. The Green Mountain Club asked if I would judge a nature outdoor poetry contest. And I said yes. And I was super excited to do that. And we had about 70 submissions come in. And I just sat on my couch for much of a day just reading all the poems. So thanks to everyone out there who shared them. And Barry, I loved reading your poem about our trail names. That was super. So what I did is with these 70s, I culled it down to 10. And if someone else were judging it, they would probably come up with a different 10. If someone else was judging it, they would come up with a different 10. So these are just the 10 I chose, but there are so many wonderful poems. And then what I did is I took those 10 and my wife and I one night, we sat down and we read each one multiple times. And then we had conversations. And one of my favorite things about the conversation is I would talk about what I love and my wife would love a completely different part. And we had a really wonderful discussion about which poems we thought should win. And then what I did is I got it down to 5 and I was supposed to get it down to 3. And I did a bad job of that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to announce 2 runners up and then the grand prize, the second place and the honorable mention. And the grand prize, second place, and honorable mention, they're all going to be both online and in the spring Long Trail News. The grand prize gets a $50 gift certificate. The second prize gets a $25 gift certificate. So we'll start with the runners-up. We have Jack Marowski for the Summer of 13, which is a beautiful trail-building poem. I completely loved it. And this was just a wonderful poem. And then Sonia Scher's Road Stop was a wonderful poem about where humans and nature intersect in surprising and stunning ways. So these could have been winners. And I debated a long time with my wife on which one should win. But now we're going to get to the three winners. So honorable mention is Elizabeth McAllister's Leaving You at the Start of the Long Trail. Elizabeth and her husband, Dan, they lived in Vermont many years, and they enjoyed the state's beautiful trails, I'm sure, including the Long Trail. Dan hiked the Long Trail in parts over the course of a few years, and now they live on the coast of Maine. And this is Leaving You at the Start of the Long Trail. You were just on your way again, your smile crooked as the branches haloed around your head, your eyes gold like the canopy framed behind. Your flesh and blood exchange for sun and shadow, so that when I turned to look one last time, you were gone. And I love that poem. I love its condensedness. I love how we get both the image of a person, let's assume it's Dan, heading off on the long trail, and the trail, and they merge and they become one. And we'll see this a lot, this interaction of humans and nature. But I just love the concise beauty and the imagery of this poem. Congrats, Elizabeth, on writing an amazing poem. Second place, we have Mitchell Nobis for 7:15 a.m. Third Floor Making Copies. And Mitchell is a writer and public K through 12 school teacher in Metro Detroit, just east of where I lived in Grand Rapids. And he lives there with his wife, kids, and dogs. He grew up on a dairy farm, and life in the suburbs still makes him a little itchy, a feeling I know well, Mitchell. And Mitchell, I saw that you were here tonight. I hope you are doing great. Thanks for writing a beautiful poem. You can find him at Mitch Nobis or MitchNobis.com. And this will be a two-page poem. 7:15 a.m., Third Floor Making Copies. I stand in the company of clicks and whirs, knocks and hums, waiting for a machine to warm up, waiting for my head to clear of the dense weight of slow morning. I watched a panic moth flittering at a window. It bumps the glass over and again, trying to get out. The endless tangle of electric wires and phone lines, the mass of treetops, so many miles off in the distance. And the thing I love about this poem, or some of the many things I love, is number one is I love this intersection between humans and the natural world, this moth beating its body against glass. But then the other thing I love is on the other side of that glass is this endless tangle of electric wires and phone lines, the mass of treetops so many miles off in the distance. So we get the human world, the natural world, and I guess we're all really a part of the natural world, all blended together. Just a stunning, beautiful poem with really some amazing images. And then our winner is Claire Chomentowski with an untitled poem. Claire lives in Roxbury, Vermont, and has lived there for 45 years. Nature has been her fondest passion since childhood. She retired from her work with nursing home residents and developmentally disabled adults, and now runs the Roxbury Food Shelf and is an Airbnb host. And a quick story about this poem is Claire mailed it to me, and it arrived before any of the other poems did. And this was the very first poem out of her poems or any other poem that I read. And I loved it, but I assumed that, you know, just because it was the first poem I read, it would not be the last one standing, but it is. It couldn't have been less than fatal, the collision involving my windshield and a butterfly, an event I'd never guessed at, except for when the sun smacks the glass, just so. And then I am awestruck, hardly seeing the road before me, my eyes drawn instead to that smudge of incandescence, stuck in my line of vision, thin and gauzy like a skin graft from a rainbow trailed by a streak of something white. They say comets are nothing more than a patchwork of dirt and debris, gleamed as they streak past the stars. And so I contemplate the symbiotic relationship that beauty bears to dust. So I love the way this poem looks on the page. I just think it has a beautiful aesthetic to just how it lays on the page. But beyond that, I love how we start with this idea or image of a butterfly hitting a windshield, and that's it. And then we explode into our feelings about it. We're awestruck, and we just keep returning to this smudge on the windshield. And this is a very mundane thing. We all have these insect smudges on our windshields, but Claire lingers and lingers. And then not only does she linger, but all of a sudden we end up in space, somewhere outside the skylight right here, watching a comet go by. And then the final thing I love is this last line, that beauty bears to dust, or I guess last two lines, such a beautiful ending. So Claire, Elizabeth Mitchell, congrats on the wonderful poems. It was an honor to read them, and it would be much more of an honor to actually hear you read them instead. But thank you to everyone who submitted. It was so fun reading them. And that's the end of my talk. And what I think I'll do is I'll shut off my screen, and then Chloe, we can head on to the next stage.
Awesome. Great job, Sean. That was so wonderful to hear all your different poems and the way you sort of weaved your storytelling and your narrative of your time leading the trail crew right into the poems. I think that was really unique, and I hope everyone else enjoyed that as I did. So we do have a good 15 minutes to answer some questions if folks want to put them in the question and answer box or in the chat. And I will read them out loud and have Sean answer them. We have one comment from Tom McCone, who was recently published in the Long Trail News. Nice to hear from you, Tom. And Tom's comment was, I am enjoying listening to you read your poems. I like how you've organized your presentation by blending stories and poems. So you can tell your wife you did the GMC proud. So that was from Tom.
Well, a quick thing there is I did not come up with this idea. My friend Steve Coughlin, a great, great poet, used to be a Boston-based poet. He and I went to grad school together, and every grad student had to give a reading. And I went to Steve's, and I'd never heard Steve read. He's a very reticent guy in terms of his own writing. And he started reading, and he actually started talking, and he was just telling this wonderful story. And at some point I just realized he was reading poems and telling stories at the exact same time. And I just was in awe of what he did. So anything I do is trying to emulate Steve Coughlin, great poet, read his work, a great friend of mine, and failing spectacularly to match what he did.
Well, it was wonderful. And have you always been a writer? How did you come into your current role as an author and poet?
I think I got into writing the way every other writer does. My mom told me to keep a journal, and being the very good son in my family, I actually did that. So when I was 12, I think she first told me, and I did not do it. But then in college, she said, you should write a journal. So I did, and I did it every single day, and they're all in my attic, and they are horrendous. And it'd be like today, I ate breakfast with Nancy, you know, at the cafeteria, and this is what we had. We had pancakes and French toast, and she complained about all the food. And it was just horrendous writing. And I did that for about a decade. And then a friend, someone who's actually here tonight, recommended that I submit some of my journal entries to a literary journal out in Colorado. And I did. And they accepted it and published it and sent me $350, which was kind of shocking because I'd literally never tried anything like that. And it was one of my better paychecks for many, 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 many years. But that kind of started me down the idea of maybe I could make this something more. And then my best friend, John Hausdorfer, he told me I should go to grad school, and I'd never considered grad school. And John just said, well, you love to read, you love to write. So I applied to one school, the school that he was living nearby, and I figured I would go for a week and then drop out and get most of my money back. And instead, I went and I realized that I was a huge geek, and I had not known it my entire life, and that what I loved was creative writing. And I found my people, and they're still my people. And then I was a horrendous writer in grad school, and I just really leaned on what my dad taught me and what trail building taught me, which is work hard. And the harder you work, the better you'll do. So that's kind of how I became a writer. A lot of it completely by luck.
Wonderful. Great. We had a bunch of good questions come in, so I'll run through some of these. Kathy is asking about your long trail hike. When did you hike it? What direction, if you went north or south? And are you still completing that hike, or do you have a next hike on the list?
So 2018 and 2019, mostly northbound, but southbound anytime it worked better for our schedules. So Barry, known to my wife and me as Uncle Bear, he and I were juggling everything. And we'd be like, well, what if we did this way? What if we did that way? And so we just hiked it any way possible. We finished at Journey's End with his partner, Aunt Alicia, and my wife and my daughter in 2019. And then my next hikes are probably less my hikes. And hopefully, if my wife is able, I want her to hike the 4,000 footers in New Hampshire. And regardless, I want my daughter to be hiking more and more. So whatever she's able to hike is what I'll hike.
Great. And then Ruth asked a question, probably inspired by the title of your book, which is, did you teach or use crosscut saws when you were working with the Northwest Youth Corps?
Yeah, we worked in wilderness many times. So we'd often just have crosscuts. And sometimes our only project was to crosscut, and we'd literally crosscut through trees shoulder high, and we'd spend 4 or 5 hours on a single tree making, you know, two cuts into it. I love a crosscut. I think it's one of the most beautiful trail tools. Probably if I had to have two trail tools, it would be a crosscut and a hog hoe. But yeah, I love the crosscut.
Mm-hmm. I think many GMC volunteers or former Long Trail Patrol crew members fondly have the same affinity for the crosscut saw as well, especially working in wilderness areas. Bob asks, this is an interesting question, where did you get the energy and time to record all those details and memories of your Northwest Trail crew experience?
I have a terrible memory for the most part. There is so much I don't remember, but I'm really, my memory is grounded geographically. So if I think about a place, I remember that place. So I actually have quite a few of what's called specs or specifications. And you'd go into the woods with this sheet of like 5 or 6 printed off papers, and it would tell you everything about where you're going to take a shower, to how to get to your trailhead, to what tools you need, to your project, to your contact. But I never looked at it for the book, because really with this trail crew, it was my first crew, and it's just stuck in my brain. I love these crew members. They mean the world to me. I don't know if any are out there tonight. I don't think there are, but I, you know, they are family to me. So the memories are just in my brain, and I'll never forget them to the day I die.
And is this book mostly about your first season with the crew? Cause you went on to lead about 4 years, right?
Yeah, this is the first season. And I did combine some of the locations, because we moved around so much. So I just tried to slow the locations down, because it got really, really, it would be just really confusing for the reader to understand week by week. But yeah, this, I did it from 1996 to 2004 intermittently. Mm-hmm. I've got, you know, 300-400 days in a tent, at least just from those experiences.
Wow, that's a long time. So we have a couple other nice comments in the chat. And again, thanks to everyone who submitted poems and helped make that poetry contest what it was. You really surpassed our expectations. And you can all keep an eye out for those in the Long Trail News, which is GMC's member publication. Howard asked, what do you teach at Norwich?
Oh, yeah, actually, I saw that, Howard. And Howard, thanks for your early comment a long time ago. I didn't have a chance to thank you for mentioning teaching at Norwich. I'm very happy to be there. I teach mostly creative writing, or writing in general. I'll teach everything from professional writing, public speaking, to creative writing, environmental writing, sports writing. If it's writing related, I teach it. And it's an honor to teach there. I love working with the Norwich student, which is a really unique sort of student. Quite a few of our students have a military focus, And quite a few like Drew out there have served. So it's just awesome to teach them.
Awesome. And Howard had another comment, which I think would be of interest for a lot of people in the audience, which would be Sean would be a super addition to our volunteer long trail patrol, which is you can go out for a week stint with a professionally led trail crew. And it's a group of volunteers that work on the long trail and side trails all summer. So whether that's a possibility for you or anyone else who's listening, we have the volunteer long trail patrol, and then we're also hiring for our seasonal trail crews. So if some of the experiences that Sean shared in his poems about swinging trail tools and living in a tent, if that piqued your interest, we run crews from about June through October. You can work just the summer if you're a student or have other scheduling. So that's just a shout out for a GMC Long Trail Patrol if you're interested.
And before you move on, a couple of things. Number one, trail crew life is an amazing life. It's hard. Running a youth corps was really hard, but just also amazing. So I highly recommend that. It transformed my life. And then the other thing is, I would love to be on that volunteer crew. I'm going to, I'm the advisor for the backpacking club at Norwich, and we're going to volunteer with the long trail. We were hoping to do it in November, but then Vermont was Vermont and we got snow. So we'll be doing it in April or May or whenever we're going to get out. So, you know, plan on seeing my Norwich students out there. And then my wife, my daughter, and I will all be out there as soon as my daughter can learn to chainsaw. She's going to turn 5 in 7 days. So I assume that'll be next year.
Yeah, she's ready.
She's ready.
Okay, so we'll just do, we just got two more, so if we can run through these quickly, and then I'll close out so everyone can get back to their evenings. So Jeff asked, where did you go to grad school and why?
I went to the University of Idaho, and I wouldn't have known this when I went there, but it's the best place to go to grad school in the nation. You know, I had the best mentors in Mary Clearman Blue, Joy Passanante, and Kim Barnes that anyone could ever have. I'm only here talking with you because of the University of Idaho and those mentors. They just you know, think of an unruly bit of wilderness. And then a trail crew coming through and putting a trail in. And that was my mentors shaping me into anything. But the reason I went there was because my friend John lived right across the border. And he said, why don't you come up here? You can live with us in our basement and go to grad school. And they let me in. And it was the only school I applied to. I had no desire to go to grad school. And going to Idaho transformed my life. And I mean, it taught me everything I need to know about who I am today.
Awesome. And then our final question from Allie, which I believe was inspired by one of your first poems that you read. Do you still have those logger boots or the Dickie shirt that you got when you first started training, or did you wear them out?
Yeah, Allie, I still have that hickory shirt. It's got the both shoulders are trashed. And those same hickory boot, the same logger boots. Yep, I still wear them. So it is great getting a question from you. I hope you and Idaho are great. But yeah, yep, I still got those logger boots and that hickory shirt. And the hickory shirt is falling off. So I don't wear it anymore because it won't stay on.
But still made to last for sure. So that'll conclude our Q&A. Thanks everyone for asking such great questions and being a part of this. I'll just close out with a couple of things. First of all, you know, we're not in person and we see your questions, but we can't see your faces. So I think that we should all give Sean a virtual round of applause. So if you want to just type some exclamation points or some claps or emojis into the chat for Sean, we really appreciate him being here. Thank you.
And then just before you move on, the same is in reverse. I would so much rather be in person and I'd so much rather be thanking you. You all are, you know, I wish I could see, I wish I could say hi and talk to you and give you hugs. So I miss you all very much.
Well, thank you. So just as we end the webinar in just a moment here, you will see a survey link pop-up, and that just has a few questions about, you know, how you heard about the event, your involvement with GMC, and there's room to leave any feedback if you have any. So if you can take a few minutes to complete that survey, that really helps us out. And then our next Taylor Series speaking event is next Thursday, 7 p.m. right here on Zoom. And that's Rich and Sherry Larson. They're longtime GMC members and volunteers, excellent photographers, and they'll be sharing stories and photos from their day hiking adventures in Arizona. So be sure to sign up for that. I will just paste the link for all of our upcoming events into the chat. We have a great lineup this year. Quick shout out to Lauren Currier, who's GMC's education coordinator, who set up a lot of these events. We're grateful to him. So with that, Sean, is there anything else that you'd like to leave us on?
No, just thanks so much to the Green Mountain Club, the Long Trail, to Vermont, and everyone here. I can't wait to see you on some trail sometime soon.
Great. Yeah, and we're looking forward to your Long Trail Poems book. So. All right. Good night, everyone. Thank you.